Typically, we're given a function f of x, and then from there we take its derivative, and then we can find out lots of things about the original function or lots of things about the derivative. We can graph the derivative and, you know, all those sorts of things. And so you might consider that going forwards. However, if you're given the graph of the derivative, you can actually reveal a lot of things about the original function just based off of the graph of the derivative. Now, this is historically something that students struggle with a little bit for this reason. The reason is that students forget that this is not the graph of f. This is the graph of the derivative. And so everything's a little backwards. Just for example, just as one quick example right here, you wouldn't think to look at that and say, oh, well, that's a critical value, because it doesn't look like a critical value at all. However, this is where the derivative equals zero. So it actually is a critical value for the original function. So you just have to be very aware that this is the graph of the derivative and not the original function. So let's take a look at some typical questions that are asked given the graph of a derivative. Okay, first up is, where's the original function increasing and decreasing? Very common question, very, very typical. So looking at this, let's just remind ourselves, what does it mean for a function to be increasing? F is increasing if its derivative is positive, right? So we're just going to look at this guy, and we're going to try to resist the temptation to look at where this graph is increasing. That's not what I'm asking about. I want to know where F, the original function, is increasing. And that's where the derivative function is positive, meaning its y values are positive. So looking at this graph, it looks like where this yellow highlighted portion is, from here to here, that's where the derivative is hanging out above the x-axis. It's hanging out up here, not down here. So from here to here is where it looks like it's increasing. Now let's throw some numbers in here, just so we can actually write some intervals down. Let's say this is the interval from, we'll just make these up, maybe -2 to 5, let's say. Okay, so we would say that the function is increasing, f of x is increasing on the interval from -2 to 5. Now, they will give you those numbers. That's not something we'll typically do. I just didn't write them in before I started the video. They'll have these x values plugged in for you. So it's increasing on that interval. All right, now, where is the original function decreasing? Well, let me change colors here. That would be obviously where the derivative is negative. So wherever f prime is negative or less than zero, then the original function would be decreasing. Well, the derivative is hanging out below the x-axis down here and down here. So that would be from -infinity to -2, union with 5 to infinity, right? So that's where the, again, I got to stress, the original function is decreasing. All right, a couple other typical questions. Where does the original function have maximums and minimums? Well, let's just think again. What does it mean to be a maximum or minimum? Well, the first derivative test, which you probably remember, says that if your function changes from increasing to decreasing, then this x value right here in the middle has got to be a maximum, because the graph goes up and then down with a critical value in the middle, which, by the way, a critical value is where the derivative would be zero. So let's go back to this graph up here. And I think we already identified this part, that -2 was a critical value because the first derivative was zero there. It went through the x-axis. And 5 was a critical value, right, because the derivative is zero. And then check it out. At this first critical value, the graph goes, or the original function goes from decreasing to increasing, because its slopes go from negative to positive. So decreasing to increasing, that means that this guy would be a relative minimum, because the slopes go from decreasing to increasing, negative slopes to positive slopes. And then positive derivative to negative derivative indicates that 5 would be a relative maximum. So we have a relative maximum at x equals -2 and a relative minimum at x equals, did I get those right? I'm sorry, I got those backwards. Relative min at negative 2 and a relative max at 5. Min at negative 2. Sorry about that. Minimum negative 2 and maximum at 5. Okay, so one thing that unfortunately we can't do is oftentimes when you want the relative min or max, your instructor or teacher will want the x, y coordinate. Well, we got the x, but if this is a graphical type example, there's really no way to discern what the y value for the original function is at negative 2. All you know is that negative 2 is a critical value, but you don't know how high is high and how low is low. So typically they'll just ask you just for the x coordinate for the relative maxes and mins. All right, now knowing all that, let's see if we can graph the original function. So we'll take what we know so far. We've got a maximum at 5 and a minimum at negative 2. So here's negative 2 and here's 5. Okay, but remember, there's no really way to discern what the y values are at negative 2 and 5. So this is simply just going to be a sketch of the shape of the graph. And so I'm just going to put a minimum just somewhere at negative 2. And I'll put a maximum just somewhere at 5, something like that. Okay, so I've got a low point and a high point. Now, let's examine just for a minute before we go any farther, because you might be asking this question in your head. Why can we not be more specific than that? Well, think about it. If this is the derivative, then if we could somehow magically find the original function, it would be blah, 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 have a bunch of terms, and then it may or may not have a constant on the end. Okay, it could be plus 7, minus 2, plus 3, whatever. What would happen to this constant when you take the derivative? What would happen to this guy? Well, it would go away, right? It would go to 0 because it's a constant. So if this constant was happened to have been plus 7, and your graph was up here, you would not have known that because it went away with the derivative. Or your graph could have been here, or it could have been like a plus 5. Could have been down here, it could have been a minus 3, we don't know. So basically what's going to happen is we will get the correct shape of the original function, but it could be high or low or somewhere in the middle, and there's no way to know because with the derivative, all those constants would have gone away that made it fluctuate in height like it did. So we're just going to put a just a generic low point and high point. And let's see here. It decreases up to negative 2, it increases from negative 2 to 5, and then it decreases after 5. Okay, so I buy that. So it'll go decreasing, increasing, and then after 5 it'll be decreasing again. Okay, now in hindsight, this makes perfectly good sense. The blue graph looks roughly like a cubic equation, like a degree 3 equation, and the derivative looks like a quadratic equation. It's a parabola that opens downward. And a quadratic is the derivative of a cubic function, so everything seems to make perfectly good sense. Okay, so this blue graph is the original function where the derivative graph is shown in green. Okay, now that's pretty much the majority of what you would be asked. Now, I do have one extra little thing now, since I've already got all the work shown. So you're welcome to go into the next video, but let's just hang out just for another second and ask, what would the point of inflection be, or can we tell that? Well, if you remember, that's where a graph changes from concave up to concave down. So we can cheat a little bit and just look at the original function and see where it's changes from concave up to concave down or vice versa. So right there, right here would be a point of inflection on the original graph at this x coordinate. But let's see if we could have revealed that from the derivative. Let me erase all this stuff now that I'm done. What on the second derivative could have helped reveal that we had a point of inflection right here? Well, notice that's where the derivative of the derivative, in other words, hint, hint, the second derivative, that's where it equals 0, right? And the first derivative went from increasing, so the derivative of the derivative, in other words, the second derivative was positive, indicating that it was concave up, and then it changed to concave down. Now, did I say that this graph, the graph of f prime, changed from concave up to down? No, that's not what I'm saying. I'm saying the second derivative went from positive to negative, indicating the original function went from concave up to down. So sure enough, we found a point of inflection as well. I don't have that listed as an x value. It looks maybe somewhere right around 2 or something close to that. But anyway, right here would be a point of inflection. So anyway, hopefully that that reveals or kind of explains a little bit how you can read or reveal things about the original function based off of the graph of f prime.